My name is Donal O'Connell. Today we're going to build on what we've already learned about the physics of the Higgs mechanism and see it working in the context of our best current description of particle physics, which we call the standard model. So let's recap with a simple version of the Higgs mechanism, which involves a vector field, which I'll call A, and draw like this, and a scalar field, phi, which I'll draw with dashed lines. Phi is the Higgs field in this simple model. Let's think about the number of different kinds of particle states in this simple model. The vector field A can fluctuate in two different directions. These are its two different polarizations. So it can fluctuate up and down, for example, and then it can fluctuate from the left to the right. So there are two kinds of particle state for the massless vector field. The scalar field in the simplest model we've considered also had two states. They were phi1 and phi2. So the total number of states in this model is 4. After symmetry breaking, the scalar field phi takes on an expectation value, which breaks the symmetry. Consequently, the vector field A becomes massive. Now, a massive vector field has three polarizations. The total number of polarizations in the model has to be the same after symmetry breaking, just the same as it was before symmetry breaking. Before symmetry breaking, we had 4 polarizations. So after symmetry breaking, there must be one polarization left in the scalar field. This we interpret as a physical Higgs boson. Let's look at the interactions in this model in a little bit more detail. There are two kinds of interaction between the scalar field and the vector field that we'll be interested in. The first of these interactions involves two scalar fields phi interacting with one vector field A. The second interaction on the right involves two scalar fields phi interacting with two vector fields A. The second of these interactions is more important for understanding why it is that the vector field gets a mass when the scalar field breaks the symmetry. This second interaction is associated with a term in the potential energy of this form. It has two powers of the scalar field phi and two powers of the vector field A. In addition, in the potential energy of the model, there is the scalar potential, which has the property that it breaks the symmetry. The scalar field's potential energy is minimized when the field takes on a non-zero value at all points in space. We call this value the field's vacuum expectation value, and we write it as V. When the scalar field phi takes on its vacuum expectation value, V, the structure of the potential gets modified. The scalar potential is now minimized, and meanwhile, the interaction term between two scalar fields and two gauge fields becomes a harmonic oscillator potential for the gauge field. You see, the gauge field now is just multiplied by constants. So we can't shift the vector field without changing the physics. Because of this harmonic oscillator potential for the vector field takes on a mass, which is given by G times V. As we learned before, we need two kinds of vector particle to explain beta decay. These are the massive W minus and W plus. Let's now see how we get these from the Higgs mechanism in the standard model. In the standard model, there are three kinds of symmetry. Only two are relevant for beta decay. The first of these symmetries is SU2. The group is SU2, there are three massless vector particles associated with that symmetry. We call these three massless vectors the Ws, W plus, W minus, and W3. There is also a U1 symmetry. Because it's U1, there is simply one vector field associated with the symmetry. This is the massless vector field B. Now in the standard model, to break this symmetry, there are 4 scalar fields. In honor of Peter Higgs, we'll call these scalar fields H. That is H1 up to H4. Let's look at the SU2 interactions in a little bit more detail. SU2 is associated with three massless vector bosons, which we call the Ws. These cause interactions between pairs of particles. For example, they cause interactions between up quarks, U, and down quarks, D. One such interaction allows an up quark to split into a down quark and a W+. That interaction has strength, which we call G. Similarly, a down quark can become an up quark and a W-. This occurs with the same strength, which we call G. The W3 boson interacts such that the type of quark remains the same, but it distinguishes between up and down quarks by having a minus sign between the strengths of the interaction. In more detail, the strength of the interaction of a W3 with an up quark is a half G, while the strength of the W interaction with down quarks is minus a half G. One very peculiar thing about nature is that the SU2 interaction only operates on the left-handed component of a fermion. So in these diagrams, rather than the up quark and the down quark interacting with the W3, in fact, it's only the left-handed component of the up and down quark which interacts with W3. Now that we've seen how the particles interact in the standard model, let's look in a little bit more detail at how symmetry is broken in the theory. The process is much the same as in the simple model we previously discussed. Diagrammatically, the process involves two scalar fields, in this case the Higgs scalar H, and two vector fields. There are a couple of vector fields involved in this case. The vectors are the B and the W's. The diagram here is associated with a term in the potential energy of the model. Now the symmetry is broken when the Higgs field takes on a vacuum expectation value V. When that happens, the term in the potential energy takes on the form here. It involves the vector field B, vector field W3, and the vacuum expectation value V of the Higgs field. The B interacts with strength G prime, while the W3 interacts with strength minus G. The minus comes about because our convention is that the part of the Higgs field that breaks electroweak symmetry interacts with the W3 just like a down quark, so it gets this minus sign. All of this stuff gets squared. Now it's easy to manipulate these terms into this form here. So we can pull out two powers of the V, like so, and we can also choose to pull out a combination of the couplings G and G prime in this form here. Everything else that remains, we call Z. So here's the definition of Z. It's a combination of the W3 vector field and the B vector field with some coefficients. So it's a linear combination of vector fields. Z itself is a vector field. But we see here that Z is a massive vector field. This equation is a simple harmonic oscillator term for this Z. The combination here, V squared times G squared plus G prime squared, must therefore be the square of the mass of Z. So we learned that the Z boson mass is given by this formula here. The Z boson is a combination of the W3 and the B vector bosons that originally appeared in the model. We can understand this combination quite simply. So to do that, we fit these combinations of the couplings, G and G prime, in a triangle. The hypotenuse of the triangle is the square root of G squared plus G prime squared. The other two sides of the triangle are just given by the couplings themselves, G and G prime. Now let's call this angle theta W. Theta W is known as the weak mixing angle.
The reason for that is that the cosine and the sine of this mixing angle are the quantities here that appear in the combinations of W3 and B. The cosine of theta weak is simply g over the hypotenuse here. Similarly, the sine of theta weak is g prime over the hypotenuse. So this combination here for the Z boson is just cosine theta weak times W3 minus sine theta weak times B. This is a combination of W3 and B which gets mass in the Higgs mechanism. However, there's another combination of W3 and B that doesn't get mass in the Higgs mechanism. This is just the orthogonal combination of W3 and B, and it's given by sine theta weak times W3 plus cosine theta weak times B. This vector field A is what we call the photon. It didn't get mass in the Higgs mechanism, so it is still a massless particle, and it's the particle that you're using to see me right now. Now let's look at the total number of states in the model, both before symmetry breaking and after symmetry breaking. Before symmetry breaking, the particles are easy to list. We had three kinds of massless W, we had one massless B, and we had four kinds of Higgs field, H1 up to H4. The number of states is easy to compute as well. Because there are three massless Ws, each massless W having two polarization, remember these are massless vector bosons, they contribute a total of six states. The massless B vector boson contributes two states. The four Higgs components contribute a total of four states. So adding it up, there's a total of 12 states in the model. After symmetry breaking, we interpret these states a little differently. We already described that there is a massive Z and a massless photon, the A. These contribute three states for the massive Z and two states for the massless photon. Now, similarly, the W plus and minus get mass through the Higgs mechanism, so they contribute a total of six states. Now, we need to get 12 states in total, but so far we've only found 11. So we need one more state. This state is the Higgs scalar state, H, which was recently discovered at CERN. One interesting thing about this model is that we only wanted to get a W plus and W minus to explain beta decay. But along the way, we found an extra massive boson, the Z boson. This was a prediction of the model. It was discovered at CERN in 1983. In a 1964 paper, Peter Higgs made an important prediction. We have it highlighted here. Higgs says, "It is worth noting that an essential feature of the type of theory which has been described in this note is the prediction of incomplete multiplets of scalar and vector bosons." It's just such a scalar boson that has been discovered. It forms an incomplete multiplet in the sense that we've only seen one of these scalar bosons. But the symmetries would lead us to think that there is more. For example, before symmetry breaking, our theory consisted of four scalar bosons. But after symmetry breaking, only one of them is left. This incomplete multiplet of scalar bosons is what we interpret as the physical Higgs scalar.